you doing?
I'm all right. How are you?
You know, I mean, I'm hoping for a sliver of good news, you know, which I haven't gotten yet about this coronavirus stuff. And I'm hoping, you know, I'm just hoping. I went outside yesterday. I try to go out an hour a day, take a walk, and there's still a lot of people around, you know, without masks, you know, without gloves, huddling together.
Well, some people want to ignore this. Unfortunately,
yeah.
People. Hopefully, you know, it'll get better soon.
I mean, could people actually think this is a hoax? That it's.
I hope not. Go into the hospital, you'll see it's not a hoax.
I mean,
go into any hospital in New York, you'll know. Talk to a nurse, talk to a doctor, talk to an orderly in the hospital, they'll tell you.
I just hope everyone's safe out there, keeping their family safe, and let's hope for the best, my brother.
Episode 5, Talking Sopranos.
Yeah, but before we get into that, I want to ask you something, you know. So, over the years, and now you've been acting way longer than me, so I was, you know, at the hotel, so I dealt with a lot of entertainers and comics and singers and big acts, you know. I mean,
who was the best tipper?
The best tipper. Jerry Lewis gave me $20. Tony Danza gave me $20.
$20 is the best tip from a celebrity?
But that was a good tip years ago. I mean, years ago, I'm talking to celebrities. But I had a guy, the best tip I ever got when I was a maitre d', $400. Guy gave me 4 black chips for a front row seat to Crazy Girls, which was a topless show in the hotel at the Riviera. $400.
That's a big tip.
But I'm talking celebrity wise. Slappy White gave me. Remember Slappy White?
I do.
He gave me $20. Jerry Lewis gave me $20. Tony Danza. You know, celebrities, you know, Soprano guys are different. You know, Outkast, we tip. Jim was a big tipper. You're a
big
tipper.
We were big tippers. Yeah.
I'm tipping. Stevie Van Zandt, big tipper. You know, most guys, celebrities, think you're doing them a favor. And they don't tip nothing. They won't even tip. Listen, Tiger Woods is the worst tipper in the universe. Scottie
the
Pippen.
The best golfer, but the worst tipper.
The worst tipper. Scottie Pippen. They call him in Vegas, no tipping Pippen. And they call Michael Jordan, Harden Michael Jordan.
Oh.
These guys have unlimited money. I'll tell you another story. My buddy's on a crap game at the Mirage. Ben Affleck at the time was dating Jennifer Lopez. Big gambler, Ben Affleck. Generous guy. You know, he's winning. He wins a ton of money. Leaves $1,000 for the boys. $1,000 in chips he throws on the table. Jennifer Lopez picks up $500. That's enough. True story.
Tales of Las Vegas, huh?
Sinatra, one of the biggest tippers. You know,
that's what I hear. Yeah,
he was one of the biggest tippers. He would give the money to Jilly, and Jilly would delve it out. You know, but so over the years, you've met. I mean, obviously, you were one of the leads of the show. You've met a lot of celebrities that were fans of the shows, fans of the Sopranos, as I did, and I'm sure some were very complimentary and very nice to you, Did you ever have any pricks? Was anybody rude to you? You're an Emmy winner. You're a very well-respected writer, director, producer.
Well, one year I was nominated for a Golden Globe. And I went to there's an after party. Then the agents all have parties at restaurants like CAA, the big agencies. Then there's after party.
At the Golden Globes, after the Golden Globes.
I was hanging out with Annabella and the two of us went, she took me to this party at the Chateau Marmont, the after somebody sweet.
Annabella Sciorra.
Yeah. Very well. We go way back to Jungle Fever.
Yeah. You know,
I played her brother in that. So she's a very good friend. So you go in this suite, the Chateau Marmont, and it's all huge movie stars, like the biggest stars. Most of them are plastered drunk, which A-list. Was a little bit surreal. Yeah, just shit-faced, most of them. And most of them are very nice. A couple of them I knew. A lot of them I didn't know. Some of them were very nice, even though they were drunk. And there was this one guy. I'm not going to say who he is.
Come on.
No. That's not my style.
It's just me and you here.
Yeah, that's right. He's from Australia or England, I think. He had either Australia or England. And I think Mira Servino introduced us. Mira's a good friend of mine. We worked together a couple of times. And said, oh, he's on The Sopranos on HBO. And he was like, I don't watch TV. He was really drunk. And I said, well, you should, because it's as good as anything you do. Which he didn't like hearing. And then, of course, he wound up on TV like pretty much everybody else who was in the movies back then. And
who was it? Hugh Jackman?
No, Hugh Jackman's a great guy. I met him on the set of a TV show that I did.
All right, now I'm going to rack my brains.
But who's the best? You know, the best, when The Sopranos hit, it was very surreal having people that I was big fans of.
Sure. Absolutely.
Come up to me. So I was doing a movie in Toronto and I was staying at the Four Seasons. And the Stones, it was 2002, the Stones were touring. So I got a ticket off of, you know, some agency. And Keith Richards' manager approached me and Eli said, are you going, you want to come to the show? I said, I got a ticket. She goes, I'm going to the sound check. Do you want to come right now?
Wow.
So I get in a car with her. I get to the arena where Toronto hockey team plays. The sound check, there's nobody there, you know? So I'm standing right in front of the stage. Keith sees me and goes like this.
I've met him a few times. He's a good guy.
And then he starts playing. The next song he plays is his song. Was it Open All Night? The one that was in the end of season two. Used it on.
Yeah, yeah.
And then they invited me backstage. And Ronnie Wood said, you know, we haven't played that song ever on the tour. He's playing that for you. And I hung out with them before the show. And then they invited me back to the hotel.
Wow.
After the show. So come to the Four Seasons. They're staying at the same hotel. So I'm thinking, now the show is great. The White Stripes opened. They weren't really that big then. I met them backstage. They were, you know, Jack White. And it was Meg White. It was a fantastic night. The concert was great. So after the show.
And you're alone. You're by yourself.
I was by myself. I was working up there. So they invited me to come up to the suite. So I'm thinking it's going to be some crazy party with God knows what kind of debauchery. I get up in the suite and it's Keith and Ronnie Wood. That's it. And me.
That's it. So it's late at night.
It's about maybe 12, 1. And we hung out, drank till 5 in the morning. Just talking about life. And there were moments where I just had to say, you're sitting in Ronnie Wood's hotel with Keith Richards and Ronnie Wood. And they were just, we hung out for 2 days. We went to the art museum the next day, which was closed, and they opened it up for us.
Wow.
For them, not for me, but that was phenomenal. Yeah, they were really, really great.
Did you meet Jagger?
I met Mick and Charlie, yeah. Charlie's very friendly. Mick's okay.
No, he wasn't. Tell the truth. I know you're lying.
I love Mick Jagger. Mick Jagger fan.
But you're lying.
No, he was okay. You know, he's. I think if you're not a sexy young woman, you could get a little bit of an attitude.
Or maybe, all right, whatever.
But Keith and Ronnie.
And you've kept in touch with Ronnie, right?
I did for a while. I haven't seen him, but we met up in New York a bunch of times. But they're the greatest.
I met Keith who came to season 3 Soprano premiere.
Yeah.
And then I met him at Bruce Willis's party. But, you know, I told you, so I worked with a lot of comics and a lot of people in Vegas. Our first Emmys in 2000, I had been on the show the second season. HBO was nice enough to bring me and my wife to the Emmys going into season 3. I never do this. I never go up to celebrities. I'm in my tux. I'm very excited. The Emmy Awards, I mean, I was a fucking bouncer not that long ago. I see Ellen DeGeneres, who worked for me in Vegas. I go to the bathroom. I come out. I wash my hands. I say...
That was kind of you.
Yeah, Ellen's talking to somebody. I say, excuse me, I hate to interrupt. Ellen, I don't know if you remember me, but, you know, I used to run the Riviera, the improv at the Riviera, and you worked for me. She dismissed me like I was a piece of gum on her shoe. Like, how dare you talk to me? Wow. Honestly. And it wasn't, oh, yeah, even a fake. Hey, yeah, good to see you. How you doing? Just dismiss me. I fucking slinked away. Slinked away like an asshole. George Clooney, you know, I used to do a lot of Tonight shows. So I got to meet a lot of celebrities there. I used to do, I was a correspondent for Leno. So I used to do the bits. And Clooney couldn't be a nicer guy. Courtney Cox couldn't be nicer. I mean, some of the biggest stars, they're just nice people. And you're surprised when they know you. Ball players, you know, Kobe years ago gave me a hug in a Knick game. And so stuff. And then you got assholes. Now, De Niro, we know, is an asshole. Not because of his politics. I worked with him. He couldn't be ruder. You say hello to him, he's stuck for a fucking answer if he doesn't have a script. You don't have to answer. I don't want to get you involved in this.
I worked on Goodfellas with him, and he was very, very kind to me. You know, okay. I was a young actor. All I right. just started, and he...
Maybe he didn't like me. You know. Maybe he just didn't like me. So that's possible, and that's okay. Now, someone that I disliked from afar, and I just thought she was a pain in the ass, and I was so wrong, Madonna. I met Madonna at the Tonight Show.
I like Madonna.
I never liked her.
Very cool.
She knocked on the dressing room. My door was open. She came in. Loved a bit.
Yeah,
loved
she's
the Sopranos. She was great. Now, a little thing. Werner Herzog. You know this guy?
Of course.
Big director. Werner Herzog. I
if
met
Fitzcarraldo
him.
Is a very good movie.
Yeah. I think he's
Aguirre, Wrath of God. That's a
he's a good director.
Klaus Kinski stuff.
He's so. A good director. I get a call. My agent says Werner Herzog wants to meet you about Bad Lieutenant. He did the Bad Lieutenant 2 or something, a remake of the Bad Lieutenant.
Yeah, it was horrible.
Yeah. So we were shooting Hungry Ghost. You let me out early. You know, you were directing that movie. I meet him on the east side on Park Avenue in the hotel in the lobby. I meet Werner Herzog, sit there for an hour talking. Great conversation. It's going so well. He shakes my hand. I'm very jubilant to have you in my movie.
So that basically, as an actor, you take that I'm in, because people don't usually say that.
Shakes my hand. I'm very
Nobody,
jubilant.
Nobody, they never tell you you're in unless you're in.
No audition. He didn't audition people. This was... the audition, sit down, talk to him. Shake hands. He continues to talk. In my head, I'm going, let's not fuck this up. Let me get the fuck out of here. I got the job. Let me zip out. Step outside. My manager calls how to go. Yeah, it was great. I think I got it. Never heard from him again. Never. Gone. He didn't have to say you got the movie.
Yeah, that's a bad move. That you should never, so, you know, it's hard and vulnerable enough. You dodged a bullet because that movie was, the first one is a masterpiece. Abel Ferrara with Harvey Keitel, one of the best movies ever. I mean, I'm a huge fan of that, but I thought the second one just was a disaster.
Sometimes you meet people and, you know, you respect them, you like their work, like you said, and you're disappointed. And sometimes, you know, you're wrong. You know, you judge a book by its cover. I'm very guilty of that. Clint Eastwood, I worked with, he was a big Soprano fan, you know. And
well, Lou Reed was a big fan, and he was my hero. And I got invited to his show, and he couldn't have been more gracious.
99.9% everybody that I've come across over the years, all good people and nice, except for fucking Werner Herzog. All right. Let's get on with the show. Go ahead, Michael. We got college episode 5.
Episode 5, which is this episode won an Emmy for the script. I think it was the first Soprano episode that won an Emmy. Written by James Manos and David Chase. James Manos went on to create Dexter.
Yes.
Very good writer, really good guy. He had a script about this married couple of spies that he wanted me and Gina Gershon to do, but never wound up getting the money or going to hell. But it was fantastic. I really like Jim. He's a very talented guy.
I'll tell you a little Jim story. I believe he lived in Brooklyn. I played basketball against him. He was a great basketball player at Poly Prep. Really? He broke Poly at the time. Now, this is the late 70s. I'm older than him. Late 70s, he was the all-time leading scorer at Poly Prep. I believe he went to and or played at Cornell. He was a really good ball player in Bay Ridge.
You were a good ball player.
I was a good ball player. Manos was a really good player. He was small, but he could shoot. I've never met him except for...
He's a good dude. Very smart guy.
40-something years ago.
Ball, right? You played college.
I played in Brooklyn College. Yeah, I played 3 years at Brooklyn College. But that's a little something. When I saw Jim Manos, I couldn't believe when I saw the credits, I went,
"Yeah,
that's the same guy, and it's the same guy."
Very talented guy. This directed by Alan Coulter, who did a lot of Soprano episodes. Also did X-Files, Boardwalk Empire, Sex and the City, a lot of big shows. And interesting movie called Hollywoodland with Adrian Brody about George Reeves,
who
played Superman on television.
Really good guy.
Alan's a really good director.
And a good guy, too.
This episode is very interesting because... It's a very self-contained episode. It's almost like a little movie. You know, it stands alone. And I think it's very dear to David Chase's heart for that reason. You know, it's a self-contained, like the way the Pine Barrens is, although the Pine Barrens is much more comedic and this one's much more dramatic in tone and intimate, you know, in terms of the family stuff and the affairs of the heart and things like that. Also, most Soprano episodes are structured with three stories intertwined, an A story, a B story, a C story. Uh-huh. This episode really only has two. And I think it's because he really, or the writers really wanted that focus, you know, that very narrow focus and keep this as a standalone little world unto itself.
So this one, the A story is Tony taking Meadow to college. They're gonna visit three schools in Vermont. And the story of Carmela and Father Phil, which is a new Father Phil.
Paul Schultz, great actor.
There's no Junior, no Olivia, no Sylvia, no Pussy, no Paulie. This is not really a gangster episode.
A little bit.
Yeah. But you know what I mean. The guys aren't around. There's no Bada Bing. None of that's around, okay? Jamie Lynn told me something that... I saw it in an interview. She had so many scenes with Jim, and it was still early on. And I don't know if it was in the restaurant or in the car, and she was a little anxious. And Jim said to her, "Just look me in the eyes and talk to me. That's it.
That's basically acting in a nutshell."
And he calmed her down. She did incredible work here.
Yeah, I think that's what Spencer Tracy used to say. Just look him in the eye and tell the truth. Spencer Tracy, one of my favorite actors. You know, that simplicity sometimes is the greatest thing.
Well, I think mostly it is.
And honesty.
And there's some moments here that are just so real.
Yeah.
I mean, just so real. I mean, you know, if I'm not mistaken, HBO did not want... Tony to kill the guy, right?
Well, when they read the script, they were afraid that the fans would turn on Tony Soprano. He's the main character. The first few episodes are kind of getting into him and liking him a lot. And then HBO was afraid that fans would turn. And David Chase actually said, no, the fans are going to turn if he doesn't kill this guy.
Yes, yes.
Because it's going to make him look weak. It's going to make him look not an honorable mob guy because this is the code that they're living under. This guy was a rat. This guy turned on the family, you know, and to live by that code, he's got to do this.
Is this the first time a main character in a TV series murdered someone?
A leading man, I guess, yeah. Well, I mean,
I would say so.
The other murders on our show, yeah. Well, he's the star of the show.
I mean, this is the first time. I mean, you didn't get Dick Van Dyke didn't kill nobody. Gilligan. I don't remember.
I wish he did. Telling. That might have been interesting.
I don't remember. You know what I mean? Desi.
Well, maybe a cop show. They'll kill a bad guy, but this is kind of a cold-blooded killing.
Absolutely.
Up close and personal.
A passionate killing.
A crime of passion and a crime of vengeance and stuff. It's not just
this, this was ranked number 2 on TV Guide's list as one of the greatest TV episodes of all time.
Oh. Yeah, and they're supposed to be up in Maine looking at colleges. And actually, it was all shot in North Jersey and I think Rockland County, New York, on the border of Jersey and New York.
Oh, I thought, why did I say Vermont? It's Maine, right? It's
supposed to be Maine, but they did, like the college scenes are shot at Drew University, which is in, I think, Madison, New Jersey. Yeah. And it starts with them, you know, touring a college. Jim
yeah,
has
but Tony Ray Rossi. Tony Ray Rossi. Let's talk about him. He plays the snitch, Fabian. Great, great, great job. Tony's been around a long time. He's been in a whole bunch of movies. Usually plays a mobster. A really, really nice guy. And he's the guest star here. And he does a terrific job.
But the show starts with them touring colleges. You know, and Tony, it's just Tony and Meadow. Carmela's sick at home, so she doesn't go on the trip. And you see their relationship a bit, which is nice because it's outside of the home, outside of the daily grind of family life. And, you know, talking about colleges and she's interested in this school. They get to go to India abroad. And Jim says, what do you learn in India? How not to get diarrhea, which is the first of two very dad jokes that he tells. And she brings up one of the things they call this college is that it's the most expensive form of birth control, which he doesn't like to hear.
No.
Bates University. That's the one that they're touring. And then they're in the car and she bluntly, point blank, asks him if he is in the mafia.
And his the look on his face is priceless. You know, it's priceless when he looks, when the look he gives her back. Like, what did she just say?
Yeah, and it's her character really develops in this episode because we see her strength as a person, as a woman. You know, she's, you know, she understands what this means, and she also understands, that there's a certain amount of secrecy that is going to be necessary.
But I think she kind of likes it. She says the kids are in school are impressed, and I think she kind of likes it. You know, later on, as the series goes on, you see she doesn't like it. She's older and more mature, but...
Right. But there's a thing about power and what it brings her and the position it gives her. I mean,
you know what the thing is? One thing about Tony, he lies. He can lie very easily. He lies as he breathes. He lies...
Well, that's a big theme in this episode. You know, the truth and the lies. You have... Later on, when you read that quote from Nathaniel Hawthorne, you know, we'll get into that a little more specifically. But, you know, lies and truth are a big theme, running theme in this college episode. Throughout the series, really, but they really nail it in this. All right, we'll get to that.
So, at the gas station, Tony calls
Irina. Calls Irina. She brings up her cousin, Svetlana, who we actually meet later on.
She's got a prosthetic leg.
She becomes the maid, right? In the
yeah, but she's got a prosthetic leg. She tells
and he has an affair with her.
Later on.
Later on, yeah, it's amazing. She's great. But Irina's given him pressure. She feels bad that she doesn't have a husband.
Yes, and she said my cousin with the one leg, she found the guy, and her leg fell off, and he carried her up. And what you say, like a white...
A knight in white satin armor. Which is confusing two different tropes there. Right.
I mean, again, strange humor. The prosthetic leg, why is it funny? I don't know why, but it's funny. In that scenario, the leg fell off. The husband picked her up.
It's very specific. That's why this show is great.
I think actually Janice steals her leg. They have a beef and she steals the leg.
She steals the leg, yeah. Fantastic. So this is at the gas station. This is when he sees Febby Petrullio for the first time. And Alan Coulter's, you know, throughout this episode, particularly in the scenes with Febby Petrullio, is this very stalking, like he moves the camera in very stalking ways. It's very voyeuristic. It's very, you know, from the point of view of somebody watching someone else.
Yes.
Try to stalk them, to try to seek.
And very cat and mouse the whole time. Tony, yeah. Very cat and mouse.
The camera where Alan's camera work is really, really good. A lot of handheld stuff. It's very interesting the way he did it.
Tony chases him. He called Meadows, talking to a couple guys, get in the car. Drives like a crazy man. She's suspicious and scared, okay? She's suspicious what's going on, and he's crazy, smiling, going against traffic, tells lies the whole way. There was a quote, I mean, he tells lies somewhere as if he's breathing, you know? As easy as he's breathing, he could tell a lie, make up a story. No thought to it, you know?
That's how he's had to live. That's part of his life, you know, his livelihood.
Then Tony
truth can call, get him killed.
Tony calls Christopher, says, "Call me back."
Christopher's pissed off because it interrupts his pool game.
Exactly, and it's pouring out. He says it's pouring out.
Well, this is another great detail. It's like, okay, there's a metaphor with the storm and a dark night of the soul and all this stuff, but it's just a great. If it was just a regular sunny day out and Christopher had to do the phone, it's just so much more interesting. It's not just raining, it's pouring rain. It's a deluge. And
Now let me ask you something. Because I've never been in a scene where it's raining, except for when it's really
raining. That's a rain machine. Rainmaker.
Rain machine, and it just comes down, it's overhead.
It's like a giant sprinkler. It's like a big, tall post with big propellers. And it spins around, and it's like a shitload of water coming down on your head.
And then, you do a take, they dry you off the best they can, change your clothes, you get back in there.
Pretty much, yeah. We shot that very close to Silver Cup Studios, like down the block or something, you know, on the payphone. It didn't need to be any kind of specific location. But, you know, the detail, it's an obstacle, right, for Christopher. Like, it's not just on the phone with Tony. It's pouring rain. He can't hear so good. It's long distance. He's on a payphone. It's great. You know, it's like nothing's ever just cut and dry and just generic or taken for granted. You know, it's always very specific. And
And nothing happens by accident. It's there for a reason.
It's there for a reason, you know.
All right. So the Soprano house, AJ makes breakfast. Carmela's in bed. She's not feeling well. A bad breakfast. AJ makes her. She is under the weather. She tells AJ to go to his friends.
But even the scene, you have the mother and son and the father and daughter, and the writing and the acting on every front, the awkwardness and uncomfortable elements between a parent and a child are so
even
real,
a little
so honest here.
AJ goes to kiss her goodbye. She backs up, no cooties. Very real. Every moment is so real. It's not like a TV show, you know? I mean, it's amazing to rewatch this. Okay. Tony explains the Fabian story, right, to Christopher.
And he was a guy who was selling drugs. And he got caught.
Bad guy.
He ratted out the whole family and got into witness protection, but then left.
So he's telling Christopher to run the plates, and he tells him the story about the bust. And
right, he made a bust out of wood of Frank Sinatra that Christopher thought was Shaquille O'Neal, the guy you would rather fight than a mouse.
Absolutely. We go back to the Soprano house, right? So Father Phil arrives. He is a freeloader. Father Phil's a freeloader.
But here's what I want to know. Did Edie plan on having him over because Tony was out of town? Or what, what was this?
No, I don't think so. He says he was at the charity drive, whatever. He came over. He had a hankering for Big Z.
Would he have come over if Tony was home? Does he know Tony's not home?
Maybe in a conversation before that. Well, I think he does know that they went up to visit schools.
Well, that's
He does make mention of that. He comes over. He's very slick, Father Phil. Slicker than snot, this guy. Comes over. He's drinking a wine. Carmella Smitten goes to the
Carmella's mirror. Getting
she primps herself up
in the mirror.
I mean, what, do you do that? Who does that when the priest is coming over? You know,
being, well, that's what I'm saying. Maybe Carmella called and said, hey, yeah, you know, why don't you come over and watch a movie or have something to eat, you know?
Don't think that's it. He says, I just had a hankering for baked ziti. She comes by. Oh, you know, you men, you love to eat, she tells him. I think Carmella, not I think, Carmella likes the attention that Father Phil gives her. She doesn't get that from Tony.
She likes the attention. She likes the fact that he's a priest, that, you know, there's something there that she respects, but she also likes his sensitivity, I think, the attention, the
absolutely
gentleness, maybe, the,
so
you
she,
know, the intelligence.
Even though she's not feeling well, she pours, she's drinking wine, and, you know, she puts out snacks, but...
Yeah, and he's just, with the food, oh, Cajun stuffed olives. And
he's a freeloader, you know, this guy.
He's a freeloader. He loves the food, the wine. The Chianti is amazing. He's
He yeah. knows it's good wine. I mean, he's got, we'll get into that a little bit. But Tony and Meadow have dinner, okay? So Tony says, how'd that sit with you? The stuff we talked about him being involved with the mafia. And he says, listen, at that time, there wasn't a lot of options. And she gives him a zinger, you know, like Mario Cuomo. All
right.
You know, she gives him a little zinger like, hey, he wasn't in the mob. He did okay for himself, you know, so.
He wasn't in the mob. He also, you know, I played Andrew Cuomo in Escape at Dannemora. So I got to meet him and spend some time with him. And he told me that his father never saw The Godfather. Mario Cuomo was very, you know, he was very conscious about negative Italian stereotypes.
Oh, I'm sure.
And,
I'm sure.
But at the time when Mario Cuomo was coming up, you know, that there was still a lot of prejudices towards Italians. There was still a lot of there was still a lot of preconceived ideas and connecting Italians to the mob. And he had to fight against that kind of thing. Do you know the mob? In the early 90s, after Mario Cuomo was governor, when he was out of politics, he was going to Italy on a trip. I think he was doing a speaking engagement there. And the Sicilian mob wanted to assassinate him.
Really?
To send a message that they had the power to, you know, to kill high-ranking officials. At that time, a high-ranking judge was murdered in Italy who went after the mob. And they wanted to do this as a message that they could get to the Americans, and wow. And they were going to kill him in the center of Messina in Sicily, in the square.
And he was going to do some event.
No, I read about
somebody
this.
Else. Okay.
So when he got to Rome, the mob looked at his security detail, and they realized it was way too heavy, so they canceled that.
But thank God for that.
There were plans on trying to assassinate Mario Cuomo.
Wow. I did not know that. So they're having a conversation. He says, "You know, I'm very proud of you. You're my adult daughter." He's sitting across the table, and she feels comfortable enough to let him know that she did speed, right? That she took the crystal meth. And Tony does, like any father, is not happy about that.
Wants to know where she got it.
I would have been even more pissed off. He took it way better than I would have, but. That's not here nor there. And first of all, she says, I got something to tell you. And he says, you think she's pregnant. Right? That's the first thing, right? You're pregnant?
That's always the biggest fear, right?
He doesn't take it well, but she's honest with him. She says, now that, you know, she's an adult, we're adults, you told me this, I'll tell you that. So it kind of, it's a good moment between a father and a daughter there. They're having dinner.
He immediately, and this is always the case, they want to know where you got it from.
Of course.
It's like as if people are just giving it away to kids or something like that. It's like she wanted it and sought it out and went to buy it. But
yeah.
She, to her credit, I think here, does not give Christopher up.
Yes, absolutely. She says,
She could have.
She says, I won't do it again. She didn't like the way it made her feel.
She could have cracked, and she could have gave him up, and that, and maybe Christopher would have been killed for that. Who knows? But this is another, what I was saying, the development of her character and being this strong woman and, you know, kind of a mob wife in training in a weird way.
Kind of, but that takes a different
turn.
She's
not giving up Christopher. She's aware of what her father does. She also doesn't press him on certain things towards the end. We'll go into that. But it's interesting.
So back to the Soprano house. Father Phil and Carmela. He lights a fire. They're drinking wine. She puts out snacks. They got big bowls of chips or something. The
Chianti is above reproach, he says. It's a very romantic evening.
It
He's
looks
building
like
a fire.
Date. It looks like a date to me.
Tony never builds a fire. He's building fire. He's being very romantic. He's being very gentlemanly. And
she makes comment with this beautiful fireplace, and he's only lit a fire three times or something. So Father Phil's got it all going on. Very slick. He's romancing her. Make no doubt about it. Father Phil.
Oh, there's a lot of tension there between them. And I think that she welcome that, think she welcomed this
absolutely
tension.
Now back at the restaurant, he tells Meadow, why don't you go with the girls, because he's preoccupied. Tony's got work to do. He's got this snitch on his mind, and he tells her, cokes only, no drinking. She goes off with the college girls. Back to the phone booth. Tony calls Christopher. It's pouring rain out. Tony says, what do you got? Christopher says, wet shoes. If you don't like this life, you could always try out for the Yankees.
Christopher finds out the guy's real name the guy's fake name, his alias.
Just a great line, little details, you know.
Yeah, it is a good line.
That's a good one. All right, back to the Soprano.
Frederick Peters is the guy's name. So he discovers, Chris finds out the alias that he's living under and his address, wasn't that hard for them to figure this out either.
No, not at all. I guess he says he was in the witness protection program and either got thrown out or he left it or whatever, as so many of these guys do. So Father Phil and Carmela, they have dinner. All right. In the meantime, Melfi calls to cancel the appointment.
Melfi's wearing a Bard College t-shirt.
Ah, interesting. Interesting fact.
This is where our son goes.
I missed that. So yeah. Carmela says to Father Phil, why wouldn't he tell me his therapist was a female unless he was screwing her?
Yeah, and here we go back to the theme about the lying.
And which he does all the time. I don't blame Carmela for thinking this way. Father Phil at one point calls himself a snorer, which is a Yiddish word for a freeloader.
Right.
Carmela,
he's also reluctant really to talk about Tony in these scenes.
Absolutely.
I mean, he mentions
he doesn't
therapy's
knock
good.
Him. He doesn't knock him.
No, he says it's good that he's therapy, that he's in therapy, but therapy doesn't address the soul, which is what Carmela said in an earlier episode. But Phil's kind of reluctant to bring up Tony. He doesn't really want to talk about him. You can see that there's a little bit of tension around it.
Absolutely. And she wants Father Phil to talk. She asks him to talk to Tony. And
good luck with that.
Let me ask you something. But this was 1998, right?
Yeah.
I mean, no cell phones? I don't see cell phones in this episode.
I didn't have one.
Oh, I did. But you didn't drive either. You're behind the times.
Yeah, I guess so. I was much happier without a cell phone. Honestly.
But then again, I have a flip phone. So what the fuck do I know? I still got a flip phone.
I'm behind the times? You got a flip phone. Yeah. You do Instagram on that flip? Is that the only flip phone Instagram capability?
It's the only one.
You had it modified by
some
MIT guys to put Instagram on a flip phone.
On a flip phone. All right, so we're back at the snitch's house.
Tony. Well, this is very interesting. Now, look how specific this little moment is of Tony going to, stake out this guy's house, see if he could find the guy, see what he could find out about him. He's in a whirlpool with his wife, who's kind of a young, hot chick, who's naked, I think, it looks like, or something.
Comes out, you see her ass, yeah.
And there's a little kid in the house calling them. And there's a dog barking, and there's Tony watching. So it's a lot to take in for Tony. It's like, there's a dog, there's a house, there's a kid, there's a wife. How am I going to navigate this? Like, very specific elements, but together they really, they create a great picture and a great obstacle for Tony to have to overcome.
At the Soprano house, Carmela and Father Frill are eating dinner.
They're talking about the last temptation of Christ.
He's eating, he's drinking, he's talking movie. I mean, it's very much a date. He's full of shit, this guy. Full of shit. He's romancing her. She wants him to stay. He wants to leave. She goes, oh, where are you going so fast? You know, they just finished dinner. Where are you going? She wants him to stay.
Enjoying the conversation as well. She's enjoying his company. But the aspects of religion that they get into, you know, the thing about Christ, everything he said can be put into 2 hours, which is strange because that's about the running time of a movie.
Yeah. Yeah,
they're also talking about movies.
She said she heard that about the Beatles. All their songs equal 10 hours.
But she's talking about The Last Temptation of Christ. She doesn't really seem to like it very much. She doesn't understand the point of view of Cousin Zakas is trying to make.
But I think she kind of, when she brings up the 10 hours of the Beatles, I think we realize that Father Phil is lying about the 2 hours with Christ.
But then she starts talking about things that Christ said that she's not too keen on. How the thing about the sun rises on the just and the unjust alike. She doesn't like that. That kind of bothers her. She's questioning, well, why?
She says there's some major contradictions.
She doesn't like the idea that some whores are going to go to heaven before, you know, more virtuous people. She doesn't like that either. And that relates to her own life. You know, is her husband's Gumad going to go to heaven? Why? You know, and she's, I think a lot of these questions are very legitimate and mean a lot to Carmela, but she's questioning her own morals. She's questioning her own life and her own choices in terms of how it relates to her religion.
But when she says to him, where you're going, she's wants him to stay. She tells him the movie. I don't know what the movie is. If there's anything with Emma Thompson in it, you know, it's good for him. And she says, I didn't know you looked. And he says, like a beautiful sunset, no difference. And that's when she realizes Father Phil is not gay. Right there. He's not gay, Father Phil. She wants him to stay.
I think she's known that, though.
This is a date, man. This is a date. It's awkward. It's very awkward. It's very strange. I was uncomfortable. I'm sure a lot of people watched it and watching it for the first time are uncomfortable about what's going on here. Okay, so Tony on the street. They're playing cat and mouse. Tony's...
This guy's very smart.
Absolutely, Fabian. And very aware.
Very aware, very careful. He knows that this was a possibility, and he's trying to stay two steps ahead of Tony.
And he's very prepared also.
He's been living in paranoia for many years, and this is like his worst nightmare come true.
So he asks a mechanic. He goes around town. He's asking a mechanic if there's anyone looking for him. He goes to the bar where Meadow and Tony were, ask if anyone's looking for him. And then Tony is looking through the phone book, and he gets the address of the snitch.
Travel agency.
Travel agent. And
which is real shithole of a travel agency.
Exactly.
It's a little trailer in the middle of the woods or something.
And then he sees the bust, the wooden bust.
Of Ronald Reagan.
Of Ronald Reagan with the big lips. The camera goes to the big lips.
And
all right.
His technique, his woodworking technique is not so.
Let's take
is
a
not
break.
So good.
Now, Fabian, Febby, is that what we call him? Febby, the snitch, whatever you want to.
Frederick,
call him.
Fred, Febby, Fabian.
He follows Tony. And Meadow.
He's on his trail, man. I mean, he finds out, he goes to the restaurant where they're at, which I think is just by chance. There's probably not a lot of restaurants in the town.
He knows
that. He goes to the motel. There's not a lot of motels in the town. And he finds their name on the register. And Tony finds his office where he works. So they're really on each other's trail. It's very, and again, more of these shots, these very stalking, voyeuristic, you know, slow pans and long shots. It's really well done by Alan, and I think it was Phil Abraham who was the camera operator.
Was Phil Abraham?
It wasn't Alan. I think so.
Yeah. All right, Carmella and Father Phil watch Remains of the Day.
Well, it's also a scene, you know, she wants, you know, the movie's about this repressed love and all this kind of emotions being held down and love being held close. And she wants to see what book he's reading. Emma Thompson wants to see what book Anthony Hopkins' character is reading. It's a very romantic, it's a romance book, which she finds very out of character for him, but he doesn't want her to know. So it's very, obviously very reflective of what's going on in the scene between Carmella and Father Phil. And it's this scene is really incredible. I mean, Edie, particularly her acting in this scene when she breaks down and just says, "Father, I'm a terrible person. It's been building in me. I got to get it, you know, I got to get it out. I've forsaken what is right for what is easy, allowing what I know is evil in my house, allowing my children to be a part of it. My husband, I think, has committed terrible acts." I mean, and she really kind of comes, you know, unburdens herself, and her acting is
Incredible. But they're sitting very close to each other on the couch.
Very close.
Very close. And
she's very vulnerable.
When she breaks down, he is rubbing her arm and her hand, touching her. Very much so. I mean, I don't sit that close.
Yeah.
When I'm watching a movie, I don't sit like that with my
wife. No, it's an emotional affair. I mean, it's not physical yet or will ever be. But it's emotional, definitely. And what she's saying, you know, she kind of feels like the sword of Damocles is over their head and that something bad is going to happen. And it almost does immediately after the scene.
Absolutely.
You know, when Fabian has the opportunity to kill Tony and kill Meadow.
You know, she confesses she loves the lifestyle. She loves giving the kids everything. She doesn't have to worry about anything, what she wants. And Father Phil says, "Do you want confession?" He wants to give a confession.
And this and he's got his little confession kit.
It's got the kit.
To-go kit.
He's rubbing
takeout confession.
It's, you know, he's rubbing her, he's touching her. All right.
Well, that scene when he gives her communion is very sexual. She's on her knees in front of him.
She's on her knees. He's touching the top of her head.
A close up of him putting the host into her mouth. It's very fetishistic. Oh, yeah. It's very sexual.
So,
and then he drinks that whole sacramental wine. Like, he gulps that down.
He's looking
to get drunk.
I've seen you guzzle wine like that. In the past, I've seen you do.
You've done okay for yourself as well. Don't kid yourself.
So Tony and Meadow, they come back to the hotel, to the motel.
With that little moment, though, in that scene in the community when she fixes his collar.
Absolutely,
just very little subtle moment, but
and
very
back to
tense.
Back. They start out back to back. Hey, this is awkward. I'm cringing a little when I'm watching this.
It's awkward. It's very tense. And it's you know,
incredible.
Even though it's not formalized, they don't have sex, but there's this is an affair.
Absolutely.
Without a doubt. Christopher's eager to get on a plane and come take care of this guy.
Absolutely.
He says, "Give me a cunt's hair away from getting made if I can whack this guy."
And Tony says, "Stay there. He'll handle it." Christopher, once again, wants to please Tony and for his own selfish reasons. Like you said, his own selfish. Okay. So they get back to the motel parking lot. Fabian Meadows drunk. Tony's helping him into the hotel room. Febby, whatever the fuck his name is, he points the gun and he's going to shoot him. But he sees that older couple getting into their hotel room.
This is exactly tied to the previous scene when she's talking about something horrible happening to her family. Here it is.
And
I mean, it just nails that these two things are so, they go together so well. You know,
and Fabian says later on, "I could have killed you, but I didn't want to because of your daughter." That's not the reason. He didn't shoot because that other couple were there making noise.
He would have done it. I don't think he would have cared.
You know.
The collateral damage of Meadow would not have bothered him one bit.
So, as we talked about, back at the Soprano house, Carmella's kneeling in front of him. He hugs her. It's very awkward. The hug is awkward. her touching, you know, it's very awkward. He gives her communion. Man, it's so good. So good. You know.
And then AJ calls and says he wants to sleep over. And you really see in Edie, she's, you know, now the level of tension has just gone up 10 notches.
And you see, happy. Yeah, but you see Father Phil, his ears perk up.
But she's, when she gets off that phone, you could see, you know, there's something very delicious about this sexual tension to her. And she's, now it's okay. He's not coming home. We got the whole night ahead of us.
But his ears perk up when she says, oh, you're staying over there. He looks over there. He's thinking the same thing.
Yeah. Father Phil is, and she's, and maybe she doesn't, you know, listen, there's probably a part of her that knows nothing's going to happen, that she's not going to cross that line. But, you know, the part of her, just that possibility is, you know, getting her very excited.
Listen, he's rubbing her back. It looks like they're going to kiss. They get very, very close to kissing. He's rubbing her back. They're sitting, you know, they're inches from each other. No social distancing there. None whatsoever. He's got a puke. He runs to the bathroom. Tony.
But just as this tension reaches that almost something really is about to happen, he gets sick.
At first, I thought he was faking it, but he wasn't faking it. He was sick.
Yeah, which is always the deal breaker.
He was sick. Yes, yes. It's always a deal breaker. But
that'll get you out of the mood.
But she right away calls Tony. And now, does she call Tony one? Is she guilty? Or does she call to make sure Tony's not on his way home somehow? Like you do. You know, let me double check that I'm
like, who does?
You know what I mean?
What are you talking? Don't bring me into this. I got nothing to do with this.
I didn't say you, but like people do. You might call people, to make sure. Yeah. You know, I'm not saying you. But you know, you might call and say, I want to make sure no one's coming over now. I don't care if they're out of state. I'm going to double check. They ain't surprising me on the plane or you know. So this isn't the first time, in my opinion, Father Phil has done something like this with one of his parishioners.
I bet it's a pattern. I bet it's his MO. Yeah.
Absolutely. That's what I think. I don't.
He gets off on it.
This ain't a one-time deal.
But I bet he's never consummated any of it.
Really? Why do you say
I don't think so.
No? Okay.
I think this is his thing. This is what he does.
Oh, he drinks good wine. He eats. He's in a beautiful house spending the night.
He flirts, but Tony, I don't think he goes the whole month.
So Tony and Meadow leave the motel. Phoebe's watching them leave.
He's watching, and you see what he has in the car? Another little
Fig Newtons. Detail.
Fig Newtons.
What do you think that means?
Because I think he was there all night, so the sugar kept him awake. You know, he was probably drinking coffee and eating Fig Newtons. So
and he's a little relaxed.
Watch what's going on.
I think he's relaxed. He thinks they're leaving.
They're leaving town. It's over. That it was
and
just
it's
by
gonna
chance.
Be okay. Tony drops off Meadow, and he leaves. He's preoccupied. You see, he's preoccupied. Just keeps on fucking lying. I forgot my watch. Blah blah blah. I mean, he just keeps on lying. All right. See, he goes off. Meadow goes to visit her second school. Correct? Second or third school. The morning after.
Very weird vibe in the morning. She's kind of nasty. She's kind of short with him. She's a little bit pissed off. I don't know if she's disappointed. I think it's a bunch of things. I think she's disappointed in herself.
She's guilty.
Feels guilty. I think she's disappointed in him that, like, what is his deal?
Yeah,
is he flirting? What does he want? Then he got sick. I think she just feels she's hungover. It's a complicated set of emotions that's going on, and it's expressed perfectly through her and through the writing.
And she wants him to leave. AJ, you hear him, I'm home.
Don't forget your sacrament kit, which is
just a
hilarious.
That's like, don't forget your shine box. Get the fuck out of here.
It's very, condescending. It's very.
I think, and this is just my opinion, if Father Phil doesn't get drunk and start puking, something, I don't know what, may have happened. Something was going to happen there.
We'll never know.
We'll never know. But that's my opinion. Which is what makes the show so great, because there's so many, you can have input on so many different things and what it mean to different people, right? All right, Fabian tries to talk to these two junkies who are just great.
Oh, they do bring up Casablanca, which is another movie where this, you know, love affair that can't really be consummated, and it's, you know, a lot of tension in that one, a married woman. Ian, she talks about, out of all the Fanuc priests, you had to walk into my, you know, parish or whatever she says. It's so they've done this before. You know, they've had this tension before. Yeah. This is an ongoing thing.
Yeah. Okay, the junkies refuse.
Now, that's also a great thing. So the guy used to be a drug dealer. He goes into witness protection. You know, I mean, Tony has the line in the next scene, the hustle never ends when you're a wise guy. So he's still dealing. He's not a travel agent.
It's in his soul. He's a scumbag. It's in his soul.
And these two characters, the junkies, great.
The girl's great little moment. It's great.
Very detailed. And, you know, yeah, that's what he's going to do. He's going to go after these guys.
You can't take out of him, you know.
He's going to hire people like that to do his dirty work if he can get him to do it. It's great. There's also two duck whirligigs on the porch of his travel agency.
I didn't see that.
Oh, yeah. Two of them right in front of the door.
You're much sharper than me. You're a lot younger, so you're much sharper than me.
I'm not as
sharp as I used to be.
Well, they're there. They're there. I mean, obviously, they were. I would imagine they were put there deliberately.
Fabio walks outside with the gun. He sees the deer. All right. Tony attacks. He tells him, you took an oath and you broke it. Tony's very passionate. This is a brutal.
The hustle never ends. Great line. Jimmy says hello from hell.
This is a brutal killing. He's enjoying every moment of killing this guy.
He's got to get his hands dirty here. Yeah.
It is a great.
He does enjoy it.
Great scene. Tony Ray Rossi, great job, the two of them. If he didn't get killed, Tony Ray Rossi would have been a great character on the show.
I'm sure.
Fortunately, he got killed early on.
And it takes a long time for him to kill the guy. It's not an easy just shoot him in the back of the head. He's up close and personal. He doesn't have a gun with him.
That's correct, which is why he strangles him.
And then after the killing, the ducks fly away. So is it like, you know, the ducks represent the family unit, the kind of safety of his family, and they're flying away? Is it saying that the safety is out of reach because he's always going to have, wherever he goes, there's danger?
Meadow's going to fly the coop. She's not going to be with the family anymore. She's leaving to go to college. Tony picks up Meadow. She knows something's up, right? She sees the mud on her shoes. She knows something up. She's not stupid. She's a very smart kid and kind of street smart also. She knows something's up. She just says, I love you. He says, I love you.
But she also, yeah, she lets it go and kind of, this is what I was talking about, like we're not giving up Christopher. And in the beginning, when she asks him about it, she's strong and she's willing to say, this is my family, this is my father. I got to either accept him to some degree or not.
Yeah.
If I'm going to have a relationship with him. And she does, you know, it shows a lot of strength and maturity, you know, I think, in her character.
So now they go to the next college. Meadow goes on the college interview. Tony's outside.
Oh, and that's Mark Kamine, who comes out to get her. He plays the admissions guy. He was our locations guy.
Oh, really? Okay, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Tony sits outside and reads the sign. No man can wear one face to himself and another to the multitude without finally getting bewildered as to which may be true.
That's Tony. That's Carmela to some degree.
Do you even know who you are anymore? You know, really, really good quote. It says Hawthorne.
Nathaniel Hawthorne wrote the Scarlet Letter. Yeah.
Tony and Meadow return home. Carmela tells Tony about Father Phil sleeping over. She comes out with it. You know.
What do you think? Do you think she comes out with it? A, because she knows it's possible that Tony's going to hear about it because Father Phil's car was outside all night. Or B, she wants to come clean. She wants to not have lies as opposed to Tony, who's lying all the time. Or is it both?
I think it's a combination of both, but mostly that Tony's going to find out. That's what I think.
So if there was no chance of Tony finding out, if Father Phil's car wasn't there, nobody knew he was there all night.
I don't think she would have said anything.
So she's getting out ahead of it. She's trying to put it out before it comes to bite her in the ass.
He tells, you mean the guy spends the night here with you?
Monsignor Jughead.
And all he did was slip you a wafer. What did you do all night? Play Name That Pope. Great line.
That's good.
And Tony at first doesn't believe it. And then, of course, he's going to maybe for his own. I don't know if he believes it, but he says it. He is assuming that Father Phil is gay. So Tony's not worried that anything happened.
Right. Because at first he says, this is too fucked up for me to even think about.
So he doesn't know for sure, but that pacifies him in knowing nothing happened. And of course, then she brings up the Melfi called and slaps him down again. And then the episode ends, you know. A great episode, not a good one. I mean, they're all good, but this is just a fantastic episode. Now, music-wise, what you think about that? You know more about it.
Oh, there's a great song when Christopher is playing pool. That's by the band Rocket to the Crypt. It's a song called Eye on You. That's a really cool song.
And do you think, let me ask you, David, I mean, did he research these songs, or he just is such an encyclopedia of music that...
They came from a few different sources. Martin Bruce Lee... You know, in post-production
He gave his suggestions. Stevie Van Zandt gave his suggestions.
Sometimes I think the writer would. And David, yeah.
It was a great episode, man. I really enjoyed it. Good one.
Very good. Time for our Ask Me Anything question of the week.
This episode of Talking Sopranos is supported by Bose. You can experience immersive audio anywhere with the Bose Noise Canceling Headphones 700. Bose is the sponsor of our AMA Best Question segment. The winner of our AMA Best Question is Caroline from London, England. And we're sending Caroline a pair of Bose Headphones 700. Congratulations, Caroline.
Caroline asks, sorry, this is not a very deep and meaningful question. That's not true, Caroline. Don't sell yourself short.
They're all meaningful. But
they're all meaningful. It's meaningful that you wrote it in and sent it in and are listening. So it's always bugged Caroline. How old is Christopher meant to be? So in the pilot, he's supposed to be 25.
Really?
And how old Tony's supposed to be, what, 34 or something like that at the beginning?
That order, yeah.
So they're like... They're kind of a generation apart. But in reality, Jim and I were only, I think, 3 or 4 years apart.
Well, Jim was, Jim would be 57 now.
All right, and I'm 54. So we're like 3 years apart. Yeah. But so when I shot the show, the pilot,
hang on.
I was 31, although Christopher was supposed to be 25. So Christopher and Tony are about, 8-9 years apart, and Jim and I are only about 3 or 4.
Yeah, I think Jim's 50. It would be 58 now. I'm 4 years older than him. Yeah. So you're saying Christopher was 25, acts immature at times.
Yeah, in the beginning, he's very much in the season one. He's very much still a kid in a lot of ways, and I think that, you know, his impulsiveness is always there throughout the series, but I think he does mature in a lot of ways over the course of the series, that, you know, a lot of this immaturity, you know, goes away. I mean, his problems don't go away, and he's, you know.
No, but absolutely. I mean, when he says the wrong things at the wrong time, when he barges in, like episode 4, he barges in, and while Jackie Aprile died, he just has bad timing, and I think that certainly comes with being immature.
Yeah, and I mean, this is one of the great things about The Sopranos was you had characters that actually evolved over time. Like, he became more mature I feel as an actor, sure. And I felt that, you know, a lot of TV shows, you start the show, you introduce this character, take like, even especially in comedies or stuff like that, you have Seinfeld's, well, Kramer's Kramer and he's Kramer for the whole thing, or even a show like Law and Order or something like that. Well, they're the detectives and they start out and that's basically who they are. You learn different things about them, but they pretty much, Sopranos really gave you an opportunity as an actor to evolve.
Well, of course, I mean, my character evolved tremendously.
Yeah, you know, and that's not always the case on television. Well, that was, at least up until The Sopranos, it wasn't always the case.
Yeah. Great question. Thank you for that. Enjoy your Bose. I know I am, your Bose 700, Caroline, and stay safe out there. All right, brother.
All right.
Thanks for listening, and remember to subscribe to the Talking Sopranos podcast. Wherever you get your podcast, follow us on Twitter and Instagram and like us on Facebook.
Our executive producer is Jeff Sussman. Producer is Andy Verderam. Our music was composed and performed by Elijah Amiton, who used to go by the name Community Room for a brief time, but is now using his own name, Elijah Amiton, the very talented composer and musician. Our production crew includes Eric Desi, Bobby Hutch, Frank McKay, Ty Verderam, and Ciara Sharipa. Talking Sopranos is a Pod Jams production.
All right, brother. Stay safe, you and the family, and I'll talk to you soon, huh?